I said, whoops. It looks like this mic is working, right? Can everyone hear me? That's awesome. I'm so glad so many of you showed up. Thank you. Because it makes it worth my time that I put in to prepare this presentation. So I'm really glad you are all here. And hopefully I will be able to inspire you with a story about hackathons, Scrum, Agile, and Chicken. First off, let me start about me for a little while. I met my boyfriend Paul in DrupalCon London in 2011. He's in the front row, as you can see. You can recognize him, I guess. I'm a big open source hippie, and I like to sing. Did anyone show up to the pre-note? Yeah, so you have seen me singing also, right? That little thing on the left corner, that's the upper side of Holland, where I come from. I live in Haarlem and I work in Alkmaar at a beautiful company called Vakant Select, which is a glamping company. So we do glamorous camping. That's, for instance, we have two-story tents with a jacuzzi on a campsite. That's what we do. In my free time, I'm also to be found at a handball field. I'm also a referee, so that's the handball thing. And at Vakant Select, I am the Scrum Master. What I will be covering today is how can you use hackathons to move a company to agility. So how can you enforce your agile transition with the use of hackathons? What I also will be covering is how to inspire and activate people based on the new Scrum values that came out last year, and how you motivate knowledge workers. And of course, I will show you some information about the hackathons that we have been having at Vakant Select. So basically, it's the road to agility that we are following at our company. What we are trying to do, at the moment, Vakant Select is still kind of hierarchical. So we want to move our hierarchical system to a more agile organization. So we do that. We started in October 2015. We are an 80 people company and 20 people are in our developers. So basically we started at the development department. We formed three Scrum teams and we started using Scrum to get to an agile responsive enterprise, basically. Our main goal is to reach the right side, of course, a real agile company with teams formed around the management layer, but we're not there yet, since we have a lot of operational colleagues as well. And it really is a challenge, and we're really bleeding edge on using Scrum and Agile in operational teams, right? I mean, it's very... It's basically very much some software thing. It's a development thing and not really an operational thing, but we're really trying with our Scrum Master team to get the whole company into Agile and Scrum. So first off, a little bit, are there any people in the room that don't know Scrum? Because I won't be... Right. I love you guys. That's awesome. These are the three pillars of Scrum: transparency, inspection, and adaption. So the whole inspect and adapt, we try to do that every time within our teams, with retrospectives, with our whole company when we do the reviews of what we built in a sprint of 2 weeks. And above, on top of that, we also try to inspect and adapt with our customers on the outside. So we have customer panels and we try to also get the feedback from our customers. So our whole inspection and adaption circle feedback is growing in the last year, basically. So we use Scrum as a framework, because it is a framework to try and get the feedback from all the corners of the inside the company and outside the company that we need. In June 2016, Scrum.org added five new Scrum values, which I've drawn for you. that's respect. So you should have respect within a team to come to great business value, right? You need focus. You need openness. And that's sometimes a hard thing because we have so many different people with so many backgrounds, cultural, but also educational backgrounds. Courage. So be brave and do the right thing and go for it. If you see something that can change for the better, please do so. That's also tricky. Commitment. We want to deliver something after a sprint of 2 weeks. So those are the new Scrum values that came into play in last year. And on top of that, I also like to share with you what you can do with adding a little bit of how to motivate knowledge workers to that extra on the Scrum framework. Who of you watches talks at TED.com? You should. TED.com is awesome. Who of you ever watched The Puzzle of Motivation by Daniel Pink? Okay. I'm glad I can share something with you then. That's great. Daniel Pink has a presentation on TED.com. It's 18 minutes and really, really worth a watch. So please do so afterwards. And he has also written a book called Drive. And it's about what motivates knowledge workers. Because a long time ago in a factory, you should whip people when you want them to work harder or give them extra bonuses or work like that. But when you are a knowledge worker, which we all are, who we all are, that won't work for you. That won't work for your motivation. If you truly want people to be motivated, give them autonomy. I'm doing what I want to do, when I want to do it, in the way I want to do it. That's very important. Mastery, I have the skill set and I'm growing my skill set to become better at my job. So give them, do talent management, give them courses, let people go to courses to educate themselves, make them better. And purpose, that's also very important. Everyone wants to do something that adds to something higher than themselves. And that's basically also the link to Drupal and open source community that I see, is that everyone is here, most of you are here, maybe because your boss sent you, but a lot of people are also here, like me, I'm on holidays, I'm not kidding you, are here because you want to be a part of something bigger than yourself. So if you want to motivate people, please keep into account these three very, very, very important things. Because when those are in line, people will be motivated and will work hard. So, we have the Scrum pillars, we have the Scrum values, and I brought in some extra Daniel Pink love. Now what? As a Scrum Master, you have three services. When you look at the Scrum Guide, there are three services that a Scrum Master delivers. The first is to the team. So I deliver my services to the team to get rid of impediments and help them with following the Scrum framework. The second one is your service as a Scrum Master to the product owner. So you help the product owner to write better user stories and help the team better from their perspective. And the third one is you have a service to the organization. And that is why I personally really don't get the whole agile coaching thing, because there's no agile coach in the Scrum Guide whatsoever, and the Scrum Master is an agile coach. So that's just my two cents, but I think a Scrum Master is an agile coach in core. So I will never call myself an agile coach, I promise. So what I did, I took the pillars, the Scrum values, and a little bit of Daniel Pink, and I thought, okay, if I take the third one, the Scrum Master service to the organization, it says causing change. Well, that's a broad thing, right? Causing change. You can put anything under that umbrella. It says in the Scrum Guide, literally, causing change to let the organization understand Scrum so the team can perform at their best. So I was like, okay, so 25% of our company is working through Scrum and the rest of the company isn't yet. How can I narrow the gap between these two ways of working? And that's when I came up with hackathons. Does everybody know what a let me rephrase that. Does anyone not know what a hackathon is? Okay, then I'll skip that part. Everybody knows. The thing is, hackathons tend to be technical in nature. And my idea was to make it non-technical in nature. I started with a technical hackathon in October last year with the developers. And we had a hackathon of a week. So that's pretty long, right? We had a hackathon of a week and they could work on anything they liked. We had a couple of rules. You can do a project on your own or in a team. It has something to do with our company in the broadest sense of the word, so it could be anything. Do something that gives you energy, makes you happy, makes you smile, and really, well, that's the purpose part in the story, right? Do something that has purpose for you and gives you energy. You can use your own ideas or an idea of someone else. And at Friday afternoon at 3, you will be there showing something, what you did on the innovation market. So Friday at 3, you can show something you did. Turns out we did it with 16 developers, and we delivered on Friday 12 projects, from a new intranet to a new app to, well, all kinds of different projects. So that was really a great success, and the whole company came and watched what we did. So that was very, very cool. And then I thought, okay, now what? We did the whole hackathon thing with the development team. Let's bring in the Scrum value, courage. Let's just go for it. So I went to the management team and I said, I want to do a hackathon of a whole week with the whole company. That most certainly took some courage. and they actually approved. So that, and then I was like, okay, how am I going to manage this? So I'm going to give you some tips and tricks on how I did that. First off, I took a sneak peek at the Spotify model, and I formed a hackathon guild. So I asked some colleagues who were at the first hackathon, will you please help me make this happen? So my step one was forming a team, because you sure as hell don't want to do this on your own. So I formed a team, and we even got our nice logo. And then we thought, okay, we have a very hierarchical part of the organization, and we have the development part. How do we trigger people to come up with creative ideas? So we started a guerrilla marketing campaign with Little Chicken, there's the chicken, in the form of a light bulb. So it's a chicken and a light bulb in one. Because we did the hackathon at the third week of March, which is the beginning of spring. So that's why we picked that logo. I personally cut out all the little chicken and put them on magnets and spread them all over the company. And we also had some text. This text, it's in Dutch, I'm sorry. But it says, what would you do if you were the CEO for one day? So we put up text everywhere around the company to inspire people and trigger people, and there was a lot of conversation going. What is this and what's going on? And then a couple of weeks prior to the hackathon, we told everybody, okay, there's going to be a hackathon. You can be involved. You can join us for a week and do something awesome. So that was the first few steps. We did already harvest some ideas out of the company prior to the hackathon, and we asked people to do a pitch on Monday morning. So the whole company was there. Excuse me. The whole company was there, and everyone got 1.5 minutes to pitch their idea, so people could join in on the different projects. And that worked like a charm, because there are people who like to be on stage, like me, but there are also people who are more uncertain about it, and it really took them some courage to stand up in front of a whole company and share their idea, and people really bloomed that morning. That was awesome to see, because they did it, and everybody was applauding at all the ideas, and that was so heartwarming. What I also would like to mention is that the owner of the company and the CEO are sitting in front of this picture, and he's writing down all the ideas, and they were really involved. So that's also very important to have the management involved in this. What we also did is, also of course from the Scrum point of view, is we did stand-ups every day. I really like analog, so we had all the ideas hanging on a board, so people could really see and had to meet up there, so it would encourage conversation around the boards. Hey, I see you have that idea, can I join you? And this works so much better than when you have it on a digital platform, I believe. So this really worked like a charm, and every morning we came there and we said, okay, who's working on which project and where do you need help? And of course we had, ta-da, the innovation marked on Friday. What happened? At first, when we started with the Hackathon Guild, we thought, okay, it would be really great if 25 non-technical colleagues would join in. It turned out to be 75. So that was awesome, because everybody wanted to join in. And at the end of the week, we delivered 25 projects. And that ranged from a hacker band until a Vakanselect motor tour, but also a lunch club. And I have some more examples in my presentation. But it was really a great success. We were all there and having fun, and people who had their day off at Friday brought their kids to join in the party. So that was amazing, amazing. I even cried. I'm sorry. Because I would have never thought it would be such a large success. So I've got some success stories out of the hackathon. I especially like this one. We are going to move the whole company on the 1st of November to a new building, because we are located in two buildings with four stories each. So that's not very agile, right? Because you have a problem when you have to talk to other people. So we're going to move to a new building, which is one floor, which will help absolutely help our agile transition. And Suzanne, she's from the HR department. Well, actually, she is the HR department, came up with the idea, I really want to know what our colleagues want the office to look like in November. So their colleagues from all kinds of corners of the company came and made a mood board. And I'm very pleased to tell you that our director took this mood board to our interior designer and said, okay, this is what my people want. That's just awesome, right? I mean, that's empowering employees. So I really, really love that one. This is also a nice one. In the corner, you see standing Claudia and Jan. And Jan is a whole story of its own. Jan has been working at Vakanselect for, I think, approximately 20 years now. He's an account manager, so he travels to all the campsites all over Europe to get places where we can, where people, where customers of us can camp. And he's also kind of analog. He has been printing all of his emails for 20 years. And he has a lot of folders and stuff and information thingies. And this is just one of his cupboards. He had around six, I guess, full of paper. And so he told me at Friday of the hackathon, he said, Nancy, I was really stuck, because I know we're going to move soon, and I really had no idea how I should get rid of all this stuff. And in the hackathon, he came up with the idea to organize a cleanup seminar. So I think seven or eight colleagues from all around the company came and helped him clean up his mess. And all they split all the plastic and paper. They brought the paper to an NGO who can make a profit out of it again. And they separated everything. And then we had a free closet, a cupboard. And then we said, okay, now we can have a mini library. So that was also a project. So people brought from books from home and put it in a mini library. And Jan was just so touched and moved and glad that there were so many people willing to help him. And willing to help him with his problem, which he was really feeling, having a hard time about it. How am I going to get rid of all this shit? So that's also a project, right? Another one I really, really liked is the Happy to Haves. This is Martijn and Tamara and... I can't see the picture straight. We always... build a lot of software that is best for our end user, for our customer. But we also build our own systems. So our colleagues are also using our own software systems. And on the roadmap and in the product backlog, the product owner always tends to give more value to customer user stories or customer-facing user stories. But there are also a lot of bugs and things in the software where our own colleagues are having a hard time working around. So they started a project called Happy to Haves. Instead of must-haves or should-haves or would-haves, they made a list of happy to haves and asked a couple of developers, could you please help us develop these happy to haves? So it was really a great purpose for the developers, of course, because you have very direct feedback from your end user. So that was so cool, and they actually made a little crown which says happy to have hero. And this is another colleague of mine. Sorry. Who was very happy that we delivered some happy to haves. I could talk all day about this. We had a CO2 neutral accommodation. Proof of concept. We had a hacker band. We had a mystery campsite website. We had a Vacanselect Goes Green project, bring your own plants. We have an integrated blog. We did a lot of things. Intranet renewal, a cooking club, technical debt cleanup. That was somehow, if you ask developers, what do you want to do? Everyone says, I want to get rid of technical debt. Ever thought of that? Yeah, probably if you are a developer. So that's Danielle. Bye, Danielle. I'd like to share with you my lessons learned. Of course, if you look at the Scrum values again, people really aren't that courageous by themselves. It's not that if I told someone at customer service, you can do anything you like, most of them just freeze up. And that was a thing I did not think of prior to the hackathon. So you really need to give some Scrum Master love to get people out of their shells and out of their... Because they really want to join in, but most of the time they don't really know how. Because they have been in a hierarchical system for so long and they've been working with managers telling them what to do for so long, they lost that. And you really, really take that into account because you really have to put a lot of energy in it to make it happen and help people open up and do the things they like. The feeling of purpose and focus, because it's 1 week, so you have to deliver in 1 week, and the purpose is do anything you like for that is good for the company, that boosted efficiency, creativity, and energy. The whole company was literally buzzing. It was so very cool. The atmosphere, that was amazing. Give people autonomy and magic will happen. You cannot imagine what will happen if you give an 80-people company a full week of autonomy. If everyone takes one step forward, think of what a leap that is for the whole company. just dare to do it. And overall, hackathons really boosted our journey to agility. I thank my Drupal community experience for that, because I can see what can happen at sprints. I go a lot to Drupal camps and Drupal dev days and all kinds of Drupal events where people are really autonomous, because especially when you look at sprints, people do what they like, what they love, and what they think is for the better good. So I really took that out of the Drupal community and focused that on my company. So that really helped me. So thank you to the Drupal community for making that happen for me. And the last thing is, what about the chicken? Well, basically, I lost a bet, because when we had our little logo, a colleague of mine said, okay, so in the hackathon week, you'll be wearing a chicken suit, right? And I was like, sure, if you arrange a suit, I will wear a chicken suit. The good thing is that my colleagues do what they say and say what they do. The bad thing is, a chicken suit is very, very hot. Choose a job you love and you will never have to work in a day in your life. I finally know what I want to be when I grow up, and that's this. Thank you very much. I'd like to turn my Q&A session around like I did last year. Are there any people here who were at my session last year? So, you know, last year I told everybody, I'm on my own on stage and you are with like 100-ish people, right? So why should I be the one answering the questions? That's pretty weird, because most of the knowledge is in the room. So I would like to ask you something. How would you like to see this work in your company? Do you see some things that, did you take things out of the presentation that will work for you? So there's a mic over there. If you want it recorded, please step into the mic and answer my question, basically.
Hello? Yeah, is that okay? You can hear me? So I've been put in charge of running a hackathon next year. So I've always participated in them at previous companies, and that's always been fine because someone's told me where to be and I put my idea forward and that's it, and it all works lovely. So now I'm the other side of it, where I've actually got to organise one this year for a company that's never done it either. So I think the takeaway for me was the pitch idea. I liked the pitch idea, where people had opportunity to present their idea and then people could see what was happening. So I think that for me, that was the biggest takeaway for organising mine next year. Thank you.
I didn't bring the stroopwafels this year. Sorry.
Hi.
Hi.
I'm both a Scrum Master and a Project Manager, and I have an infrastructure project in Holland where we need to change the office to make it more agile and mobile for the team. And they're not really motivated about being paper light and working any desk. And I also have a Scrum Master. I'm a Scrum Master in London. So I'm thinking all these ideas are great for both projects. Just get the office involved, get people to do stuff and come up with their own ideas, and they're part of it instead of us telling them from London what they should be doing. And then in London, just try to get the sales team, marketing teams, and operations teams involved in what the development team does.
Awesome.
Thank you.
Great, yeah. There's a difference between involvement and commitment, yeah. Great. I have one more last thing. I will take the answers first, and then we'll get to, yeah.
Hackathons is incredibly valuable in the organization. One of the things that we have done is have regular hackathons. The thing you mentioned and the thing, the hackathons you've mentioned, seems like big events. You can have regular hackathons, maybe not on a monthly basis, but maybe on a quarterly basis or a little bit more often, to get that feel. Like, you know, shake people up just on a small scale, just in your Scrum team. But it just works on so many levels, on so many scales. So are you not doing hackathons? Get started.
Yes!
Hi, I'm a software developer. I would like to have in my company something like that, but I'm missing something that is the gender gap. There were some proposal or some focus on that point, because as a developer, I see that they told us or the society say that is everything done, but surely it's not. Then I would like to know if there is some, this kind of point of view when you try to change the company, if there was something related with that.
Yeah, maybe somebody has an answer already. I don't have it quite yet, but I would love to talk to you about it. I'll be here today and tomorrow, so just see and meet me. Yeah. Just one more thing. I'm currently working on a serious game about the GDPR. I don't know if anyone knows the GDPR yet. You should. Because it's coming soon, and it's winter is coming. It's coming very soon, and it's going to hit all of Europe very, very hard. I developed a serious game about GDPR for... Sorry?
What is it? Explain.
GDPR. Explain GDPR. It's a General Data Protection Regulation, which is about the privacy of your customers. If you have more than 250 customers, you have to take good care of their personal data. And you also, everyone has the right to be forgotten. So if someone comes up to you and says, okay, I want to be forgotten, you have to get rid of all the customer data in all your own software applications, but also of your third parties. So when you, for instance, if I take my company, we send out, we do 55,000 bookings a year of families, and we send all the personal data to all the campsites all over Europe. So that's sort of a problem, because when someone calls us and says, okay, I have the right to be forgotten, forget me, we have to find out which campsite they're on, and we have to get rid of the information at the campsite as well. So it really has a lot of implications for software developers and e-commerce people and customer services as well. I made a serious game to raise awareness about what the law is all about. And I'm going to give it away for free, because I'm open source hippie, under Creative Commons license on my website, happyscrummaster.com. It's not quite there yet. I think it will take me approximately 4 to 5 weeks to get it online. And then you can all use it and play a serious game about law. How cool is that? Thank you, thank you, thank you again. And have a lovely day.
Thank you.
because we have one which is in Shanghai.
Oh, wow.
We are in Croatia.
When I saw it.
So actually, we have to have like a good
view
and so on to get him to come to us. Unless it's like middle of the summer, carries a holiday, he's actually never holiday,
right.
And so on. Yeah. And he's a guy who is
one
of the and our project leader actually made a good thing. He done it one day, had a mini hackathon, and it actually turned into 3 weeks.
Yeah.
So he started working overtime just to work on our pet project. And that was also a turning point. That's an excellent hook for new people who have skills, but don't have tools. You have other skills, like my case, and I could contribute with something else, and I finally felt like a member of a team. So you also made me cry a bit. Yeah. So how to get a CEO who is remote, basically, and only occasionally present.
Well, it is occasionally present, because he lives in Italy most of the time. The thing is that we didn't really have a hard time involving the management, because
the back burner for the last 6 months.
We started this company 30 years ago.
Last year,
there was agile working and working with iterations is the same as building a
sensor.
Because I started out with a field of grass, and then I put some toilet buildings on there and made money, and then the next thing I build a swimming pool.
You get more and more stars, yeah. You grow with your customers.
So he said, building a campsite is agile in core. And I think he's right about that. And because he's so willing, and his vision is really to be an agile organization in the time that it will take, that it wasn't that hard for me to recall. But I did help him out with some projects, for instance, Undercover Boss. I don't know if you know the program, but that's where bosses of real big companies, for instance, Shell, go with a fake mustache on the floor and work with the real people.
Unfortunately, we all know our boss.
But it might be funny to put him on a fake mustache, just
for
fun of it.
Yeah, just for fun of it. Yeah. Like, the good thing is actually likes to get involved in things and contributes. Yeah. He is really proactive and so on. He really passionately cares about the stuff he does. Yeah.
There might be some ideas, or maybe ideas from himself to join in with something. He can bring you lunch, or something like that, because eating together also is a family. Team builder, right? Maybe something like that.
I was just thinking, I work at a company at the moment, there is this big issue of trust, and this big crisis, and they're all like thinking, I should hire a psychologist who can bring the team together, and I'm like, this is so much more, perhaps so much more productive to do a
thank you.
Because then you bring people together and have to work together, not just nag, and talk, but just to work proactive and together as a team. I think that
I'm also
really
a certified team coach, and that's hard work too. Because if you want to have a team, this is just the tip of the iceberg. It really goes back to the connection you are making here. If you cannot trust each other and cannot blindfile on other people, sorry for the Dutch.
We got you.
nothing will work, I think. But you could use a hackathon to build a trust.
Yeah.
And just get them out of their normal.
Yeah, everybody behind the desk, and he's sitting there, and she's sitting there, and everybody working very much in teams, and then nobody wants to work together. Everybody's
there's a difference between
teams
groups
working,
and teams.
Yeah. They work against each other, not with each other.
Yeah. This would help, because
they have
through.
To. And it's not about their daily product, what they do. So, because you come up with something different.
Did you have to coach them on how to be a team, though, when you were doing
every
that?
Day. That's what I do every day.
So you did the stand-ups
also,
and then kind of appointed them in some kind of agile, setup? How did you do that?
That's all subjects on itself. You have to build trust, and to do that, you have to get very personal on your own stories and the things that. For instance, I'm going to have a trust session soon with a new team, a new operations team, and they talk about each other more than they talk with each other.
when you tell a story like that, I can see it in your faces already. Oh my goodness. That helps building an open workspace to talk about true feelings. It might sound a bit corny, but you have to talk about true feelings before you can become a team.
Scrum Master is somebody who is in between squashing from the business and the team that are working you, so you are like, you've been squashed from the both the end. Taking all the pressure from the like you said, happy Scrum Master.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's true. Yeah. So I just wanted to thank you so much, and I think this is the one of the sessions from all DrupalCon and Jupyter.
Wow.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Okay. Wow.
I have a very simple question on how it kind of worked with what if someone's idea needed financing in some sort of way? Mm-hmm. How did you work through that?
We have that actually in the upcoming hackathon because we want to, one of the hackathon projects is organizing our opening reception for the new place where we go. So that's cool because it's organized by the people itself and not by our management, right? you have to go to management up front prior to the hackathon to arrange it. So that's self organizing. So if you need money, make it happen.
Oh, in the teams themselves, where they come up with their idea, they have to go to management and present. Okay, that's interesting. So then management has to be okay with a bunch of people.
About having a hackathon budget, but my personal feeling is that budget tends to narrow creativity instead of opening it up.
Yeah. Make sure you start with the budget.
Well,
yeah.
Right.
And then work agile. Start with a
MVP. No, I don't have a glamping card, but I do have a happy Scrum Master. Oh, where is it? It's my personal brand, though, so.
That's okay. So
thank you.
I'm going to print it on post-it notes. So I can give post-it notes.
And you did a good job singing yesterday.
Thank you.
Did you write that song?
No, Jen did.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Just